إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. Dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. I'm your host, Kareem Abu Zaid, your show, Let's Talk About It. We are making up for yesterday. We had some logistics here and there, and alhamdulillah, we decided to come today, the same time, 6:30 our time, 8:30 Eastern Standard Time, to take your calls and answer your questions, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala. Again, the phone number will be shown on the screen if it is not already there. 1-800-651-4814. You can always email your question to kareem@guideus.tv. We also have a Facebook page for Let's Talk About It. You can always go there and post your question and let us know what we can do to help you. Dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, today is the fourth day of the month of Sha'ban. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has stressed or indicated the importance of the month of Ramadan, in which the Quran was revealed, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mandated upon the Muslims to observe the fourth pillar of Islam. That is why a lot of Muslims pay very much attention to Ramadan, fasting it, observing Qiyam. Also, during the days of ignorance of Jahiliyyah, pre-Islam, the Arabs used to pay very much attention to the month of Rajab. They would actually do a lot of acts during that month. And that habit or this custom was carried on by Muslims. You will find them actually doing a lot of things in Rajab which are not established by evidence, which we would label to be innovation. So I think the point that I'm trying to make is, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, كما في مسند أحمد وسنن ابن ماجة, when he was asked by Al-Hib ibn Al-Hib, Usama ibn Zayd, the beloved, the son of the beloved, Usama ibn Zayd ibn Haritha radiyallahu anhuma, he was asked by him, O Messenger of Allah, how come I see you fasting a lot in the month of Sha'ban? And not only Usama radiyallahu anhu noted that. Ummul Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha, the mother of the believers, as it was recorded in the two Sahih, has actually made the same exact comment. She said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam would fast to the extent that we think that he will never break fast. And he would break fast for so many days to the extent that we would think that he will never fast again. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never completed the fasting of a month but the month of Ramadan. Never completed the fasting of 1 month but the month of Ramadan. And I have never, here is Mawdu' al-Shahid, here is what we're looking for. I have never seen him fasting so many days in one month the way that he fasted the month of Sha'ban, meaning that he would fast so many days. Again, I want to establish that the question of Usama was on target. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to fast a lot in the month of Sha'ban. Now, when he was asked sallallahu alayhi wa sallam by Usama, what is the wisdom, O Messenger of Allah, that you fast so many days during the month of Sha'ban? He says, ذَاكَ شَهْرٌ, this is a month, بَيْنَ رَجَبْ وَرَمَضَانِ, which comes between the month of Rajab. Remember why I mentioned Rajab at the very beginning? Rajab, the month of Rajab, from the days of pre-Islam, which we label to be Jahiliyyah, the polytheists, the mushrikeen, used to do a lot of acts during that month, used to give so much attention during that month. And subhanAllah, these habits were carried on by Muslims. That is why the scholars in the month of Rajab, their job is to warn people regarding the amount of innovations that Muslims may commit in that month, thinking that these are established acts of worship. The point here that a lot of attention was carried on from the days of pre-Islam by the Muslims, especially the later generations, to the month of Rajab. So Sha'ban comes after Rajab, so a lot of attention is on Rajab. And then Ramadan, of course, a lot of attention is there because of the fact that it is talked about in the Quran. It is a month on which, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran. It is a month on which we observe the fourth pillar of Islam. In the month, there is a night better than 1,000 months, and so forth. That is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is stressing the wisdom. This is a month which comes between the month of Rajab and the month of Sha'ban. Here is the key. يَغْفُلُ عَنْهُ كَثِيرٌ مِّنَ النَّاسِ. A lot of people do not pay very much attention to its virtue. فِيهِ, here is the virtue about it. One virtue right here. فِيهِ تُرْفَعُ الْأَعْمَالُ إِلَى اللَّهِ. During that month, your annual record of deeds will be presented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever you done from last Sha'ban until this Sha'ban will be presented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And here is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, وَأُحِبُّ أَن يُرْفَعَ عَمَلِي إِلَى اللَّهِ وَأَنَا صَائِمٌ. And I love that my deeds to be presented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while I'm fasting. So this is the first virtue of this month, and that is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would fast a lot of days during that month. We also know from authentic established hadith fi sunan, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned regarding the 15th night of Sha'ban. Watch out now. There is nothing special for you to do, but there is something that is so special which happens on this night. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inna Allah yatlu'u, here is the exact wording of the hadith, yatlu'u Allah ta'ala ila khalqihi laylatan nisf min Sha'ban. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in a way that fits him, ينزل, descends, looks upon, لا, لا, لا تعطل, do not reject the attribute of descending, do not reject the attribute of looking, لا تعطل. At the same time also, don't ask how, and don't try to visualize how does he descend, how does he look. ليس كمثله شيء. There is none like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is above having someone similar to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's above having someone equal to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's above having someone to be a rival to him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. لا يعلم كيف الله إلا الله. Only subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how he is. We only believe that he looks, he descends. We don't try to make him like in his creation. We do not try to visualize how he does the attribute. And we're not required to, we're not asked to. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never asked us to figure this out. He just asked us to believe in it and contain that belief or guard that belief with that beautiful verse, لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is no one like Allah, like into Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks upon his servants on the 15th night of Sha'ban. فَيَغْفِرْ. He will forgive, subhanallah, to all of them, except two categories. إِلَّا لِمُشْرِكْ. Except a mushrik أو مُشَاحِن. Except a mushrik أو مُشَاحِن. Someone who is guilty of shirk, or someone who is quarreling, having a problem with his brother or with his sister. Shahid, or the important thing, brothers and sisters in Islam, on the night of the 15th of Sha'ban, subhanallah, is a blessed night. Is a blessed night. Because on this night, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at his servants. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives all of them except those two categories. Someone who is guilty of shirk, associating someone in worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, praying to a saint, a sheikh, a deceased person, taking intermediaries between him and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, relying on them, asking for their intercession before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making, supplicating to them. هذا هو الشرك. Or they do perform certain acts of worship which must be exclusively performed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to deceased, to somebody underneath the ground. That is shirk right here. Or somebody who is having a bad relationship with another Muslim. And this is again another important element and piece which we must pay attention to. لا يحل للمسلم. It is not lawful for a Muslim to boycott his Muslim brother, or the Muslim sister boycotting her Muslim sister for more than 3 days. We must strive to make up, dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, in order to gain the acceptance and the forgiveness, in order to win the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on this night, which is the night of the 15th of Sha'ban. Dear viewers, we have an issue on this night. A lot of the Muslims believe that this night should be singled out with specific and certain acts of worship. This has never been established, dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam. If you are used to performing certain acts of worship, such as you fasting the 13th, the 14th, the 15th of the month, every month you fast the three white days, khalas, you're going to end up fasting the 15th. You're used to praying tahajjud every single night. You pray tahajjud every single night, every way, anyways. Yani, you keep up with it, yani. Yani, you're striving your routine that you pray tahajjud every night. If you happen to pray tahajjud on this night, that's no problem. Go ahead and do it. You every night you recite one juz of the Quran. But what we're talking about is singling out the night with certain acts of worship. It has never been established, and it is absolutely an innovation. Example is Salatul Alfiyah. There is a Salah which is known to be 1,000 Salah, 100 rak'ahs. In each Salah, in each rak'ah, the Imam recites Surah Al-Ikhlas 10 times. Never been established. La asla laha, has no basis. The 6 rak'ah which you pray, for example, some people do in order to change the qadr or something. I have no idea what it is. Or in order to better their qadr. And never been established. That's what I'm talking about. The night of the 15th is a sacred night, is a special night in the lives of the Muslims because of the fact that we strive to have tawheed, and we strive, you know, when you strive to better your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the best way to do it is to single him out with your actions, is to implement tawheed. And also you strive to better your relationship with your brothers and sisters by making up. You see, these are two things that you should work on before the night arrives. I guess I have a couple of questions. I'll answer them until we receive the phone calls, inshallah. Okay, I have two questions. Is it a sunnah to fast the night of the 15th of Sha'ban? I believe I already answered this. The question is coming from Yasir. Yasir, like I mentioned, singling out the night with the day, of course, of the 15th with fasting, never been established. But if you are a Muslim, alhamdulillah, which you are, I'm sorry, that's not a way to put it. If you are used to fasting the 13th, the 14th, the 15th, or 3 days out of each month, and you happen to choose the 15th this month, that is fine. I'm not sure yet if the 15th will fall on a Monday. And you're used to fasting Mondays and Thursdays. Or if you want to implement the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam of fasting so many days in Sha'ban. Like I mentioned, Rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam would fast a lot during the month of Sha'ban. So the important point that I'm making here is, do not single out, do not say I'm fasting because it is the day or it is because of the night of the 15th of Sha'ban. Sometimes, dear viewers, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would label a certain time to be special time. But sometimes, labeling it to be special by itself is not sufficient to initiate acts of worship. Oh, yani we know for a fact that the first 10 days of the Hijjah are very special, the best days out of the year. طيب. Then comes in the hadith, ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيها أحب إلى الله من تلك الأيام. Now comes in the hadith, which initiates or legalize performing acts of worship during these 10 days. You got it? You get it? So sometimes the days are special, the nights are special, but you still need an evidence in order to legalize the performing of deeds. Brother Yasser is also asking, my wife and I will be staying with family during Ramadan. Our family include my step-grandfather, who is 9 years old and old Christian. My wife is wondering if she needs to wear hijab at home around him, even if he is very old. It's preferred, yes, it's highly recommended that she wears hijab around him because of the fact that hijab is a requirement for a Muslim woman. طيب. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring the month of Ramadan on us and Muslims, Ummah, with peace. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen, Jazakallahu Khairan, Brother Yasir. In closing, dear viewers, regarding this issue of the importance of the month of Sha'ban, number one, our deeds are presented during that month, and Rasul sallallahu alayhi wasallam told us that it is better that when our deeds are presented to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we should be fasting. The night of the 15th, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would forgive all of us accept individuals who are engaged or indulged in polytheism or shirk, acts of shirk, associating someone in worship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you better leave off that if you want to earn the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Three, the sunnah of fasting during that month, in a way, it helps you to prepare for Ramadan. It's exactly the same concept with the nafila, with the sunan, the established voluntary acts of worship which Muslims perform before the mandatory salah. It gets you in the mood for the mandatory, so you excel with the mandatory acts of worship. So it is in a way like it's exactly like, you know, a soccer player, a football player, before he actually plays the game, what does he do? He warms up, he makes sure that the muscles are fit to handle the moves. And the same exact thing with fasting during the month of Sha'ban, but I hope that is not your intention. Your intention is to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, in closing, what should you do? I prepared all of this for you. A lot of tawbah, a lot of istighfar. A lot of tawbah, a lot of istighfar during that month. Fast as many days as possible. Three, get off any conflicts with people. Because like I said, the night of the 15th, Allah would forgive everyone except a person who is mushahin, a person who is having a bad relationship. Four, make up the days. Remember, the month of Sha'ban is the last opportunity that you have to make up the fasting which you missed from the last month. Get ready already to pray Salah in the Masjid. Get used, I'm sorry, to pray Salah, regular Salah in the Masjid. Get used to the recitation of the Quran. Get used to the recitation of the Quran. We have Intisar, Sister Intisar. I'm Shuga from Ottawa, Canada. I would like to thank you and the team for the efforts. May Allah jazakallahu khaira. Ameen. I have been following your lectures and it has great. Alhamdulillah, jazakallahu khaira. I always make dua for you, Sheikh. Jazakallahu khaira. Please make dua for me. Nas Allah yubarik fiki. I can learn about Islam, have patience, apply in my life. Shuja. Jazakallahu khaira, nukhti. Wallahi, it's very kind of you, mashallah. Hey, all this is sweet, is nice, is good. We love it. We love to hear that. May Allah reward you. And sister, a piece of advice. Learning takes a lot of patience. Be patient. But may Allah reward you. Tayyib, we have now another question from Asif. He sent that question about, if you have not answered question about, I would like to. Asif, I thought you were going to send me the question, do you civil wedding? What is that? If you're asking whether civil weddings makes it, I see something came from him right here. Let me see here. Okay, what is the ruling on civil wedding in Islam? I mean a wedding between two Muslims where no nikah was performed and wedding actually took place in a court. Jazakallahu khairah. Brother Asif, you brought up a very interesting question and it should be addressed. Dear viewers, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, civil weddings are not Islamic weddings. And even the courts in America and I believe in Canada, they recognize that. And what they give to you, actually, it is not called a marriage certificate. What they grant you is a license to be married, that you are eligible to, according to the civil law of the county or the land or the court or the state, according to the law of the land, that you are eligible to be married. That's all. Then you take this to the masjid, and you establish the wedding according to the Sharia in Islam. A marriage contract in Islam is not valid without its conditions being fulfilled. What are some of these conditions? Number one, the acceptance of the woman. She must accept. She cannot be forced, even by her guardian. She cannot be forced into this marriage. Number two, her guardian must be consented. He must approve of that marriage. Number three, two witnesses. are present. They simply observe and witness to the execution of the marriage contract. Number four is the declaration. It must be announced. It cannot be done in secret. It cannot be done in secret. Add to this al-ijab wal-qubul. Those are pillars. Al-ijab wal-qubul. That the guardian says, I have given you my daughter in marriage, and the husband says, I accept it. Those are two pillars. So this must be performed by the imam or the student of knowledge. But the marriage which takes place in the court, Brother Asif, Jazakallahu Khairan for such a good question, is not a Sharia sanction, is not an Islamic marriage. Jazakallahu Khairan. Okay, let me see here. We have a question from our sister, but a very long one. MashaAllah, I hope I can. Sister Samara, may Allah reward her. I had asked previously and had answered them, and you had answered them, but I missed the answers because Gaira's TV had stopped working. I'm watching live right now, and inshallah, remember the questions and may consider answering them again. The lecture spoke about punishment by association. طيب يا أخت سمارة, I will have, because it's very lengthy. She even recognizes this. May Allah reward her. I would not be able to simply read all of this because I would need. I promise, inshallah, we're having a show tomorrow. Inshallah, بإذن الله تعالى, we're having a show tomorrow. Inshallah, and I will read your email and I will answer it on the air. I hope you can watch us tomorrow, 8:30, Sister Samara, but definitely, inshallah, I will do this. Is it permissible to eat chicken that is halal even though it was deep fried in oil, where non-halal chicken was deep fried? That's a good one. Well, you know what, Jamal, Jazakallahu Khaira. No, it is not, because certainly the oil, I'm not really concerned about the non-halal chicken which was deep fried in the pan. I'm concerned about the other, which is the pork, basically. That is of concern to me. So I don't know what can be done at this stage, except you avoiding that. I think what we need to do, like pizza now, I remember this very well. That thing, clean cutter, is promoted. A clean cutter, even they know it. And they, when you order it, they know about it. I think we need to talk to these stores about the fact that we cannot eat unlawful meat like pork or non-halal, which was deep fried into an oil, where the halal one is being cooked. So I think like we promoted the culture of clean cutter once it comes to pizza. How pizza knew about this? Because Muslims always were concerned that when you you prepare a pizza with cutters and tools that were used previously in preparing a pizza that contain pork, you may end up carrying pieces of pork into the pizza that is supposed to be veggie or halal. As a result of this, they decided to simply promote the culture of clean cutter. I think we need to work on promoting the culture of clean oil. I think that would work. Okay, we have Nargis Sabia. Could you tell us, there is a hadith that requires a Muslim to finish reading the whole Quran from cover to cover during Ramadan. What can we do to help children cope with Ramadan, both on fasting and behave during Taraweeh? Jazakallahu khairan, Sister Nargis, for your question. Okay, it is not mandatory to finish the Quran in Ramadan, but it is the month in which the Quran was revealed. And Ibn Abbas told us that every year Jibreel alayhi salam would come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, and he would review the Quran with him. So that's where we take this, that during the month of Ramadan, the Quran at least should be reviewed one time. Because here is our Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, during that month of Ramadan, he used to review the Quran at least one time. That is where we take that sunnah of reviewing the Quran at least one time. Tayyib. Your second question, of course, once it comes to children fasting, we know of hadith Rubayya bint Mu'awwidh radiyallahu anha regarding the fasting of the day of Ashura. والحديث في صحيح البخاري she mentioned that we used to fast and we used to train our children to fast as well, and we used to encourage them by giving them toys. وكنا نصنع لهم اللعبة من العهن. So it is established that we should certainly train our children to fast during Ramadan. And actually it is established in the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we should give them gifts. So give your children incentives, dear viewers, dear brothers and sisters in Islam, that if they do fast some days or even a portion of the day, of course it would not be considered fasting but training to fast, certainly you can reward them as an encouragement. But we're talking about children who are under the age of puberty. طيب. Once it comes to Taraweeh, Sister Narjis, that's a very trying issue for the Muslims at large. I do truly think that we have to try to make some arrangements, babysitting arrangements. And the sisters can come in and do that and help the community. In every Muslim community, we should not take the opportunity and the chance and say, let's just keep the children in the masjid and everything is going to be okay, and assume that everything is going to be just fine. This is not going to happen. You know what? Let's just think about some good logistics. And some of these logistics would be certainly making babysitting services available to the community members where they can come and observe the Taraweeh and at the same time leave their children there. But I'm truly concerned about the how late this will be. That's what concerns me. Can reading the Quran benefit a dead person if done alone by individual, not Khatm al-Quran? Is it the same ruling as Hajj? I don't know why. What do you mean? What this has to do with Hajj? I see what you mean. Okay. Brother Shuja'a, dear viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, once it comes to Khatm al-Quran or the recitation, I would not read it. I would not say it's Khatm al-Quran now. I would say it's the recitation of the Quran. Very few scholars, based on the analogy which you made, the Hajj, that it's an act of worship which would benefit the deceased. The recitation of the Quran is an act of worship. If you recite it with the intention of benefiting the deceased, it can go. Because the analogy here is Hajj is an act of worship, the recitation of the Quran is an act of worship. But there are two issues here. هل يجوز القياس في العقائد? في العبادات, can you use analogy? Once it comes to acts of worship, analogy, brothers and sisters in Islam, is one of the adillah, one of the evidence that we use once we strive to come up with a religious ruling, where you have an established ruling on an issue, and you have an issue or a matter where there is no ruling, but the wisdom between the two issues, the two matters, are identical. They are identical. And because of the fact that the wisdom, العلة يعني, between them are shared, then you take the ruling that is established and apply it to the ruling that is not established. Let me help you understand this. We have for a fact, you know, a text that talks about alcohol being unlawful. We do not have a detailed list of items. There is no text for hashish, there is no text for marijuana, there is no text for opium, there is no text for, I don't know all these names, but I'm just, you know, I just, we don't say that, say opium is haram, this is haram. Now I can tell you it's haram. Why? Because of the ruling that is already in existence or existing for alcohol. Why? Because the wisdom is shared between the two. Hashish, marijuana intoxicates, alcohol intoxicates. That is why we say it's haram. كُلُّ مُسْكِرٍ خَمْرُ وَكُلُّ خَمْرٍ حَرَامٍ. Right here. Now, we do this in the area of mu'amalat, dealings. Dealings. Haram and halal. But can you apply this in the area of ibadat? Of ibadat? That's the question. There is a huge debate among the scholars. For sure, there is a consensus. We cannot use analogy in the area of aqaid, in the area of creeds. I cannot say because Allah does this, then Allah can do this. I cannot do that. I must have an evidence for each single piece of belief which I believe in. I cannot say because the deceased here, the footsteps of the people as they depart after burying him, I cannot now use analogy and say that he hears the feet all the time. No, only at that particular situation. Can we apply analogy? Can we use analogy in the area of aqidah? Consensus, no. Can we use analogy in the area of ibadah, ibadat, rituals? There is a debate. So right here, it's not established with consensus. Now, we don't have a straightforward evidence that says that you could recite the Quran for the deceased and the virtue or the reward of this can go to the deceased. We don't have a text. Now, using analogy is not established. There is a debate, but we do have legitimate وبركاته.
كنتم خير أمة أخرجت للناس تأمرون بالمعروف وتنهون